Hello, Bea here, and welcome back to Environmental Science. For today's field trip, we're traveling to Greenland to explore the Arctic tundra. How will we find Greenland on a map? I'll give you a hint. It's not green. It's white. You can probably guess that it appears white because it's covered in snow. So why do we call it Greenland? Well, it was likely a case of false advertising by a 10th century Viking explorer, Eric the Red, who called it Greenland in an attempt to draw settlers from nearby Iceland. It must have worked because the area was soon populated and the name stuck. Being that Greenland is very rarely green, do you think any life can survive here? Besides Viking settlers, of course? Only one way to find out. Let's start exploring. With its snow-covered surface easily visible from space, it will probably come as no surprise to you that the Arctic tundra is very cold, especially in the winter, when temperatures routinely drop well below 0 degrees. We get a reprieve in the summer, but here, even the warmest months will still require a jacket on most days. Why is Greenland so cold? It's very close to the North Pole. This means that the region receives very little direct sunlight. How do you think that these cold temperatures affect the hydrosphere here in the Arctic tundra? That's right. It's covered with snow and ice, or solid water. And of course, it's surrounded by very cold liquid water in the ocean. And if we were to dig under the ground, we'd find more solid water there too. A layer of permafrost, or permanently frozen ground, exists below the soil and can extend many meters below it. The permafrost helps store carbon dioxide and prevent erosion, and keeping it intact is crucial for the ecosystem. The snow above ground is critically important to the ecosystem as well because it has what is known as a high albedo, or a high reflectivity. This means that a large percentage of sunlight is reflected back to space from the snowy surface, helping keep the region and Earth as a whole cool. What kind of soil do you think we would find here in the Arctic? For soil to be fertile, other organisms need to die and decay so that their minerals and nutrients get recycled into the soil and made available to other organisms. In cold temperatures, processes such as decay are significantly slowed down. This is why we store food in a refrigerator. But how do you think this will affect the fertility of the soil and resulting biodiversity of the tundra? Pause the video for a moment and make a prediction. As we've seen, the Arctic tundra poses some significant challenges to the species that call this biome home. It's cold, with very little sunlight. The nutrient-poor ground is frozen, and there is very little liquid water available. But of course, life persists anyway. What types of adaptations do you think we'll see in the plants and animals here? Be sure to record them in the table in your notes as we go. If I asked you to name an animal that lives in the Arctic, there's a good chance that your first thought would be a polar bear. These large mammals wear a thick, warm coat of fur and have a layer of fat underneath that acts like a built-in blanket, keeping them toasty even when it's freezing outside. But their fur doesn't just help them stay warm. Can you think of any other advantages? The white fur blends in perfectly with the snow and ice, helping them sneak up on their favorite meal, seals. Polar bears are also expert ice walkers, with paws that are designed to grip the slippery surface of sea ice. And of course, they're excellent swimmers, often covering long distances in the icy waters to find food. Another Arctic animal you may be familiar with is the caribou. Though you may also know these creatures by their other name, reindeer. Makes sense that they would live near the North Pole, right? Like polar bears, they have thick fur and a layer of fat to stay warm and are also used to traveling long distances to find food, even migrating seasonally as a herd to keep the food supply steady. Having thick coats of fur is great for living on the Arctic ground, but what about the skies? The snowy owl trades white fur for white feathers. In fact, even the snowy owl's feet are covered with thick feathers, and these birds have keen eyesight, able to spot a potential snack from far away on the open tundra landscape. Great for the owl, not so great for the mouse. For animals to survive out here, what else has to exist? Remember that at the base of every food chain are the producers, which are usually plants in a terrestrial ecosystem. It's a tough world out here for photosynthesizers, with cold temperatures, little sunlight, and frozen, nutrient-poor soil. But that's okay. A few species of plants have risen to the challenge. Mosses, lichens, and shrubs, which grow close to the ground, have adapted to use shallow roots that can seek out and store liquid water. Why is staying low and avoiding deep roots an adaptation? If they were too tall, they would sustain damage from harsh winds. And remember the permafrost? It prevents roots from being able to grow more than a few inches under the ground. Many species here also have a form of biological antifreeze, which prevents water from freezing inside their cells, allowing photosynthesis to continue, even at low temperatures. With the right tools and strategies, species from any kingdom of life can find a niche here in the tundra. What were some of the common adaptations you saw as we explored the life found here? Having thick outer layers for staying warm is key, and blending into the snow helps too. Being able to find food in an environment without much biodiversity often means being able to cope with a limited diet. And you may still have to travel a good distance even for relatively slim pickings. Even if you don't live near the Arctic, you still rely on its snow cover to keep the Earth from overheating because of its high albedo and ability to send much of the sun's heat right back to space. But as global temperatures have risen over the past few decades as a result of human-caused pollution, some of the Arctic snow has begun to melt, exposing the darker, rocky ground beneath it. How would this melt-off change the albedo effect? Pause the video and make a prediction in your notes, and you'll explore this trend more in your lesson activities. Other ecological concerns in the Arctic have centered around mining and drilling for resources such as oil, rare metals, and natural gas. However, extraction of these resources can be damaging to the ecosystem and put the native life forms at risk of extinction. As a result, Greenland has recently put restrictions on the mining of minerals and has completely banned any drilling for oil and gas as a step toward promoting a cleaner, healthier planet. As we went through the lesson today, we saw how life has found a way, even in the harsh conditions of the Arctic tundra in Greenland. Despite the low temperatures, poor soil, and abundance of snow and ice, many plants and animals have found ways to stay warm and find food. going to head back to a warmer climate now, but until next time, remember, the biosphere is all around us, so keep diving into this web of life and exploring its wonders. Stay curious, keep asking questions, and I'll see you next time. Hey, hey.